This is Duke University.
First of all, I have to apologize. My apologize is that the English version of the text left my hands before I made a final correction. So there are some misleading points in there. I will do the correction before it goes to publish. We Austrians here in this room are still a little bit under a shock after yesterday's outcome of the election, and it's a coincidence that there was a real earthquake this morning in Austria, 4.2 on the Richter scale. So Austria is shaked through politically and physically in these days. And I hope that some points of my paper, at least in the second half, will explain few of the whys that's now up all over the place. Why could this happen in Austria in that way? My paper has two parts. First part is to say what is the heritage of the empire and what of this heritage could survive under Viennese circumstances, by and large. And the second part is to look to the to a province, to a federal state, to Carinthia, just to show that there are absolutely different ways of inheriting the monarchy. I think it's common sense that the sick man on the Danube, as Ernst Hanisch called the Austrian Empire, playing with an article that Friedrich Engels wrote in 1848, that he said that Engels expected the implosion of the empire. Why did this empire survive, the sick man on the Danube, for six decades after the middle of the 19th century? And I think it's common sense that there are six ingredients to this glue that kept the monarchy together. This is first the old emperor. The emperor died in 1916, and it's now all over the place in Austria, I think, at least an idea to say that the empire ended in 1916. There are books now around that the death of the old emperor was the significant end of the Habsburg Empire 2 years before it collapsed in a military sense. Second clue is the bureaucracy, administrative office. The third is the army, of course. And then fourth are the Social Democrats, fifth the Catholic Church, and sixth, of course, and most important for us here is the Jewish people in Austria. And Malachi has written a lot about why this kingdom of grace was so important for the Jews and why the Jews from all different types, they had assimilated Jews in Vienna and Jews in Galicia, why all these Jewish communities together were fundamental for the existing monarchy. I'll skip the things that I've written in the paper on Franz Theodor Jokos, 3rd November of 1918. It's boring for the Austrians because we all had to read it in school, and it's not so interesting for the Americans, I think. So I skipped this. But the disintegration of the Habsburg monarchy in 1918 at the end was a shock for many people, especially I think for the Jews. Of course, in the inner cities in Vienna and Prague, in the universities, in the Kaffeehäuser, in the coffee shops, in the newspaper, in the newspapers, in the Burgtheater, in the Salzburg Festival, in the Opera House, there could be an idea that the old empire is still alive. There could be the idea that life is simply going on. There could be the idea what Stefan Zweig called the world of yesterday, that it still exists. But even in Vienna, in the center of this new Austrian Republic, has problems in integrating the heritage of the empire into Viennese politics. I'll show this especially in one case. The Julius Deutsch case would be the other one, but we came to Julius Deutsch this afternoon, so I can skip the Deutsch passage. The Kelman story I would like to tell you. Jakob Kelman was a Galician Jew. He was 9 years old when he came in 1905 to Vienna to his uncle. He made a good fortune out in the next 10 years, got educated, had his own shop. Then he joined the army, was highly decorated on the Eastern Front. And when he came back to Vienna, first he had to cross Poland and the Czech Republic, and he was treated as the enemy in these new states. When he arrived in Vienna, he was confronted with three political groups. The first political group was the Minister of Interior, Leopold Waber, a German national politician, and he said, you can't stay here because you don't belong to the German race. But Albert Seber, the later on social democratic governor of Lower Austria and high-ranked social democratic official in that time, said that you can't stay here because we have to maintain the public order, and you are a threat to the public order in this city. So he took all his money that he had, gave it to a corrupt Christian social lawyer with connections to politics, and so he bought in this way his Austrian citizenship. Otherwise, after 10 years living in Vienna, well integrated and highly decorated in the army, even the Social Democrats would have refused under the title of Heimatrecht and sent him back to Poland, because his hometown was Poland at the time. He didn't speak any Polish. He had nothing to do with the Polish state, so it was absolutely complicated. And not to mention the displaced 10,000 of Jews living in the suburbs of Vienna, who were a threat for the social democracy in that time. And the social democracy tried not to be realized as a Jewish party. So the distance to we will talk again in the Deutsch case on that. What's striking for me is that Austro-Marxism, as we all know it, and I wrote in several books and articles on that, the Austro-Marxism before 1914 was world famous because of the books of Bauer and Renner on the national question. They stopped in 1918. There's no line on this problem anymore. There are other topics around, but they think the national question is solved because we want to be, as German Austrians, part of German cultural Europe, and in this German cultural Europe, also the Jewish parts of our population are part of this German culture. There's no longer, especially if the expected revolution would come, there's no longer a need to deal with the national topic anymore. So Bauer, Renner, and all the others stopped to write on this. I think this is all familiar to you, and Vienna and the central questions are questions that you discussed all over the place in the last workshops and so. But I think it's absolutely necessary to widen the view to the provinces, because we had a breakfast talk today that the American countries are so different, and that you have to show crossing the border to California that you don't have fruits in your trunk and things like that, but we, the small Deutsch Österreich, Austrian Republic, only 6 million inhabitants, has also a huge internal differentiation between those federal provinces, and the federal provinces were, by and large, not Lower Austria in this form, Vienna and Lower Austria, and not the Burgenland, but all the others were just built out of the previously existing crown lands. And they offered security on both a sense of continuity and identity on a regional scale. There was no Austrian identity around. This was German Austria. And even in our constitution, the second sentence was, "We would like to be part of the German Republic." There was no Austrian identity up till World War II, and it's a different and very complicated story. I mentioned it last time when I was here last year, why the Austrian identity came up so rapidly after, within World War II, starting with the Moscow Declaration. There was no Austrian identity, but there was a lot of regional, provincial identity around. It was the anthems and the flags of Tyrol, of Styria, of Salzburg, Carinthia, that evoked patriotic fervor on the provincial level and not on the state level. The regional anthems were still sung with enthusiasm up till now, and the attempt to create a national anthem in Austria in the interwar period is a story on its own, with a lot of fun and little success in there. Up till now, Austrian citizens have largely identified themselves with their province. So I'm still a Carinthian, if you ask me, and if they in sports or so on. And provincial governors still have greater political power than the federal government, which is, I think, everybody who looked to Austrian politics in the last weeks got just a proof of it, that politics is made in St. Pölten and not in Vienna, anyway. An especially interesting observation is the anti-Viennese reflex, which could be found in a variety of degrees, and it's based on different, even contradictory, reasons in the provinces. This reflex is a reaction to the ideas of Vienna as a Moloch, 2 million of people living there and only 4 million, we have to feed them and so. But it is also a reaction in opposition to Red Vienna, to Jewish Vienna, to multicultural Vienna. Vienna was called Babylon by the citizens of Graz in the last decades of the monarchy and in the first years of the republic, because Graz is the largest German city in Austria in the self-understanding of the Graz people. Vienna is not a Deutsche Stadt in the eyes of the Styrian people. And in addition, but oddly, it's sometimes in reaction to the Catholic Vienna. And the, you would not have in mind that Vienna is Catholic, but there's the Catholic Archbishop, and who and the Archbishop represents the enemy for to some crypto-Protestant provinces, especially in Upper Austria and in Carinthia. I will try in the last 10 minutes or so to give you an idea how this works in Carinthia, and to give you a short impression of my own family history that fits exactly in this picture. Carinthia is the southernmost province in Austria. You may know it in the moment as a tourist destination with the Wörthersee and all those nice places. You may know it because of Jörg Haider and other not so nice stories ranking around Carinthia. But Carinthia had fallen economically behind to other provinces in the early 19th century, because the former so decisive mining industry fell down, and most of the former mining workers had to go back to their villages. They left it once as the second or third sons, and now they came back as farm workers there. So Carinthia has the highest degree farm workers, we would say servants, Knechte, among all the provinces in Austria, and these were former industrial labor force, and they went back to the villages. So the social democracy there was built out of this farm labor force and railway workers. But in 1919, at the collapse of the monarchy, we had a red Carinthia. 49% of the voters in the first election vote for the Social Democrats, 40% for the German Nationalist Party, and only less than 10% for the Conservatives. So we have a 90% German National, the Social Democrats and the German Nationalist majority within Carinthia. The German Nationalist groups, especially dominated among the provincial elites, doctors, teachers, and so on, were politically the dominating force in this country. This is so that the Catholic Christian Democrats gained only 9%, had its roots in the Counter-Reformation. That was never fully successful there. And there's a huge crypto-Protestant movement around. And they had the feeling that the Archbishop of Vienna is the, let me say, the enemy. And they had also the feeling that the Catholic Church was the took care of the Slovenian minority in there. So Catholic means Slovenian conservative, and Protestant means German modern, yeah, to some extent. And in the villages, there was an enormous pressure on the Slovenian-speaking population to change their language that they use at home from Slovenian to German. The village where I was raised in St. Kantian had 80% of Slovenian-speaking population in the last decade of the 19th century, and only 22 in 1910. And there was no change in the population, it's the same population. But 60% of the population made the cross now with German and no longer with Slovenian, because it is easier to get the credit from the bank. It's easier for the kids at school. It's easier to make the way up in society if you switch to German, because there was the feeling of a superiority of the German culture over the Slavic culture, and so the Social Democrats had also the feeling that to speak German and to act in a German nationalist sense is a way to modernity. And the internationality of the social democracy was only to cross the border in the direction of Germany, not to cross the border in the direction of Slovenia or Italy or the other neighboring countries. Antisemitism was a topic in this discussion, of course, but not the dominant one. The highest figure of members of the Jewish community was 310. And then they declined to 260 in 1934. But there was no need that there are Jews around. Antisemitism is working without Jews pretty well in most parts of Austria, as you may know. After 1918, the Carinthian Social Democrats made considerable efforts not to be associated with the Jewish party leaders in Vienna. We are German. We are Aryans, not Jews, said the Social Democratic delegate Neutzler in October 1919 during the Provisional National Assembly. It was clear that the direction that he was thinking was to equate capitalism and Judaism, and we, the Social Democrats, have nothing to do with that. If you look what was the heritage in Carinthia coming from the monarchy? So you end up with the with the Sprachenkampf, the language war. This was traditional in southern Styria, Untersteiermark, now part of Slovenia, of the Yugoslav country, and in Carinthia, the dispute over the border demarcation culminated in a bloody Carinthian battle, the Kärntner Abwehrkampf, and this was still dominating. It's still dominating up till now, the political discussion. If you're a good Carinthian, you have to be on the German side of this battle. I'll send around a nice paint. They once threw me out of the Social Democratic Party in Carinthia because advertising, bleibt Kärntentreu. We wrote in as young socialists, duck will for the ducks, yeah? Entenhausen den Entenhausen. And this was the reason to throw me out first time. It was not the only time that I was thrown out of the Social Democracy in my life, but this was the first time. So that means that this national topic, that to be German and to defend the border, and the superiority of German culture is such a very, very strong, feeling. The editor added an extra verse to the regional anthem, vierte Strophe, wo Mannesmut und Frauentreu die Heimat sich erstritt aufs Neu, wo man mit Blut die Grenze schrieb und frei in Not und Tod verblieb. Where courageous men and loyal women fought for the renewed homeland and drew the borders with their blood and remained in distress or death, but free, something like that. So the German meant to be courageous and faithful, and the Slovenians are the opposite. German nationalism and social democracy demanded that the borders to be drawn in blood, reinforced the idea that borders were required and shaped the province. The Catholic Church was the refugium for the Slovenian, and even today in Lower Carinthia, if you go to the graveyards, you could see that in the church, and when you die, you return back to your Slovenian origins. But as long as you live and you would like to make a career and would like to make the best out of your family, it's better to be German. And the social democracy is heart of this political process. A few words on my own family history at the end of that. My father was born in 1914 as one of two children to Rosa Konrad. She was not married, she was an uneducated female farm worker, and the priest of Breiteneck in Lavantal threw Rosa out of the church, said, "No, you with your two childs, you couldn't enter the church on Sunday." So I had to stand in front of the front door. I was not allowed. So normally, if you are a gifted child in a surrounding like this, the Catholic Church took care of you and make you, let me say, to a young priest or give you a career within the Catholic society. So this was not possible for my father. So the one who offered him the career were the local German national leading figures of the provincial town of Wolfsburg, where I was born then. My father joined school there, came to teachers' academy even, and was member of the so-called Turnerbund. This is a kind of athletic association, but with highly political background. And this Turnerbund of Wolfsburg, my father including there, went to the southern parts of Carinthia and renamed a wonderful lake, the Sablatnik Lake, into Turnersee. And it's still named today Turnersee, so because this strong German nationalistic group renamed this. My father, all of them joined the Nazi party, my father too. He couldn't make a career because his Ahnenpass was father unknown, was not just a good start. So he stayed where he was, a simple member of the party. Then he went to the Navy Corps and so on. And when he came back, he still had all those ideas in his mind in 1945. But he was immediately one of the leading members of the Social Democratic Party in our village. And in his mind, he never made a change because he was always anti-clerical, he was always social, and he was always German national. And this was the offer of the social democracy in Carinthia for him. So he just continued in his work and gave me anti-Semitism was recognizable, but there were no Jews around in our village, so it was not that topic. But it was still somewhere a boogeyman where you could project one or the other negative feelings. Therefore, it's no coincidence that the Social Democrats had a position quite differently to the Social Democrats in Vienna. This is just another, a very other social democracy. And you could see now 40%+ voters in Carinthia for the candidate on Sunday, because he is the one who makes this offer exactly to this group, and not the urban left-wing urban green. This is not the way to vote. All the eight existing federal states, in addition to Vienna, have their own special way in this turn from the monarchy to the republic. If you look to Styria, to Upper Austria, to Burgenland, to Tyrol, you would get different stories. So let me say, it's not so easy to understand this this heritage of the of the Habsburg Empire within this new Austria. It's much easier to break it down to nine federal levels and look exactly what happened on the federal level. I wrote this short paper on Carinthia as a starting point for a project I have in mind to do this with all the other provinces and then to compare it, and I hope that the outcome will show you a very highly differentiated picture of the heritage of the monarchy within the Austrian federal provinces. Thank you so much.
That's a wonderful paper, and it's wonderful not only because I understood fully Helmut's response to my own presentation in Vienna, but it actually has radical revolutionary historiographical implications, which I would like to expose in my comments. So in terms of the relationship that Hacohen attempts to formulate between empire, socialism, and Jews, Helmut leaves alone the Jews and empire. He leaves that connection untouched. Although again, there we do have the problem of Jewish-German nationalism, not least among the socialists. Mm-hmm. And just yesterday night, we spoke about Hungarian nationalism in the Burgenland among the Orthodox Jews, though they would probably also switch pretty soon to loyalty to the Austrian, based on the principle that you always obey the authorities, whoever the authorities are. But the and of course there are the Jewish but local nationalisms that appear in other parts of the empire. But the relationship that really Helmut interrogates is the one between socialism and empire. That cozy relationship that Hacohen attempted to formulate, right, between what he calls the imperial party par excellence, the socialists, and the imperial ideal. And the argument here is that it's too Vienna focused. Whether it's too Vienna focused, I'm not sure, since Galician socialism plays some role in it, but perhaps it's too Jewish socialist. Focused, that is my account. And what it's clearly opposed to is to the socialism in the Austrian provinces, that is in the provinces of Austria post 1918 Austria proper. And Carinthia clearly represents the limit case. What you do have there is German national with small n, German national socialism already in the 1920s with limited traces of empire. But let me put it even more radically, reading Helmut's paper, where is empire? Mm-hmm. There's a portrait of a nationalization so extreme that it serves to challenge not only my account, not only Hacohen, right? I mean, but an entire body of US post-national scholarship that sees nationalism as an urban intelligentsia project imposed on an indifferent rural population by murderous nationalizing states. This is the current orthodoxy among people my age and younger. Right? And Carinthia, without significant intelligentsia, is an obvious case of nationalization from below. Given the easy disappearance of empire without race, actually, how did the empire ever rule? Its collapse again appears, as in the older historiography, as virtually predetermined. But let me backtrack. There are six elements that Helmut mentions as sustaining the empire, and he's, as he says, fairly incontrovertibly, the emperor, the Verwaltung, the army, the church, the socialists, and the Jews. All of these are clearly the losers of 1918. Now, a number of them, Helmut, leave aside. We are talking about here about the church and the aristocracy, and they do have their own post-19 imperial visions, and they're of great interest to me, mostly because I haven't worked carefully through them. And what happens among in those visions of such journals as the Neue Reich and other right-wing Catholic journal is that there is a process of the nationalization of the imperial vision under the notion of the Gesamtdeutsch. Mm-hmm. And one wonders whether we are there on this vision already on our way to the racial empire. But then against those, we have the Catholic cosmopolitan vision of the Jewish Catholic, right, which resists that type of nationalization. But again, those the losers' empire, as far as the church, the army, the aristocracy is concerned, this is not Helmut's concern. His concern is what happens with the socialists after the collapse of the empire. For that, what I call the imperial party par excellence. And here, I mean, what we see is indeed the empire vanishing in socialist discourse almost overnight. Mm-hmm. The way in which Helmut got to it is he spoke about the fact that they speaking about the nationality problem, because the nationality problem is presumably solved, right? Mm-hmm. I would say it in a different way. There's no longer an empire to maintain, which the entire discourse about the nationality question was part of the fact that the socialists were the imperial party par excellence and looked for a way of in which they can maintain the empire in the age of nationalism. But it's actually almost willful forgetfulness, because the empire is so unpopular in 1918 all across. Okay? It returns later in certain conservative circles in the early 1920s, but it does never returns for the for the socialists. The reason why I needed to go and recover the socialists as an imperial party is that it was forgotten almost overnight, consciously, in 1918-1919. And then they face, of course, the issue of the nationalism question, the German nationalism question, which Helmut bring under the Anschluss clause, that is the wish to reunify with Germany, which remains until the rise of the Nazis to powers in 1933, where they actually suspended. Yeah. And while I'm not sure that the cases that are shown here in terms of the attempt to exclude the Jews that are carried out by socialists are not by Viennese socialists, right? They are. It was a Corinthian one who actually issued the order for the Heimatrecht.
It became later.
The ones who are implicated in the exclusion are the Viennese socialists.
Yes, Viennese socialists.
The Viennese socialists. That's very.
The Rathaus on the highest level. So this is an unfriendly impression that mm-hmm. you got out of this Kelman.
Of Red Vienna itself, which again Helmut shows then in the very citadel of socialism and of Red Vienna, of Jewish Vienna, the confrontation with the national question leads, and the racialization of nationalism leads to Jewish exclusion. But the focus again is not on Vienna. My own view there is, in terms of the socialist leadership, that just as before 1918 they were pushed to be imperial in terms of their orientation, in the post 1918 situation, whether they are or not nationalists, they are being pushed toward the German solution because of the unsustainability, Lebensfähigkeit idea. That is that Austria cannot survive as such. The idea of joining a socialist Germany is the one that they, or a social democratic Germany, is the one, the only possibility that they can see for their own survival. So they are being pushed, regardless of the issue of how nationalist they are being pushed toward the German option by what's available and what's possible for them. But it's actually not Vienna, it's the provinces that are Helmut's focus. And here, what's interesting is that Helmut shows that there's a local patriotism and which attempts to skip over the Austrian nation state to National Socialism, that is to Germany. So the one option that is not taken by the provinces is in some way is the, that of Austrian nationalism or of the Austrian nation state. And it's that skip which I think we see already in 1918, 1919 in the plebiscite in the provinces, right, about the possibilities of Anschluss with Germany, that I think triggers or attracts Helmut's greatest interest, and is indeed the riddle that we have to solve. And I think Helmut sees it mostly as almost a reflex reaction to the domination from Red Vienna, from Basilkopf Wien, from Jewish Vienna. But then the interesting thing is, look here, I mean, is that what he hints is that we already have that type of antipathy to Vienna during the imperial period. And that it's an antipathy to imperial centralization, to urban pluralism, but also to possibility to the Catholic archbishopric in Vienna. And that's already, says Helmut, in the imperial period. And then in Carinthia, we have the case of what? Rural socialism, anti-intellectualism, anti-Slovene German nationalism, anti-Semitism without Jews, anti-clericalism, and crypto-Protestantism. This is the portrayal that we have of Carinthian socialism, Carinthian national socialism. So Carinthia demonstrates first that the leadership of the Imperial Party, of the Socialist Imperial Party par excellence, or those that I at least call the Imperial Party par excellence, the Socialists, needed to negotiate internationalism not only with its own commitment to Kultur und Aufklärung, but with its German rank and files, ethno-nationalism, all over and in the provinces especially. But I see also here a case of a decisive refutation of the post-national idea that nationalization was an intelligentsia project eventually legislated by the nationalizing state. Here we have, as I mentioned earlier, nationalization from below against the intelligentsia and against the state. So why? Why did imperial structures, church, army, and nobility succumb so quickly to the pressures of nationalization in Carinthia? And is this a typical provincial story? Notice that what the turn, major turn that Helmut makes here, and it's for me profoundly interesting, because it's the social historian turns to religion, because when the question is how did it work out historically, the crypto-Protestantism of those provinces provides the foremost explanation. But if all explanations are to be local, they are to be local not only geographically, but also in terms of time. So I need to see the way in which that type of crypto-Protestant consciousness is transformed at various stages into a new type of national consciousness. And then the question, of course, is how did the empire survive at all? So if Helmut opens with the question, after the end of World War I, which forms did the ideas take that allowed the Habsburg monarchy to persist for so long, despite the diversity of nationalism in the small republics of German Austria? What was the glue that held this multi-ethnic empire together when its collapse had been predicted since 1848, and which of its elements existed beyond 1918, those questions actually remain unanswered. They are still a puzzle. And that's the research project which Konrad students are right now going to take, and which I'm thrilled has emerged, I mean, from this type of engagement with empires. And I suspect what will emerge from that is that the answers are local, that Carinthia is different than Salzburg or Vienna, not to mention Bohemia or Galicia. That the constituencies holding the empire together are not equally effective everywhere. And if I were to guess about the picture that will generally be emerging at the end of this process, it would be one about the fragility of empire. And the second, I think we are going to vindicate the rot myth, that is the empire of minorities. The doors that empires were sustained from the margins and by minorities, rather than from those elements that became central to Europe in the post-1918 period. And so I think that this is the what I see as the revolutionary significance, I mean, of Helmut's paper, and why I think it opens a whole and sets a whole new research agenda.
May I respond to this response? thank you so much, but Malachi, but I'm quite sure most questions will be open even after this discussion, and even after all those what we can add to that. Thank you so much, because it opens my eyes to that the questions I mentioned in my first paragraph are still unanswered. Of course, what is there? What in the province that we could say is part of the story of the old monarchy? Let me put it that way. To understand the Corinthian national form of social democracy, has to widen the view to the southern border of the monarchy anyway, because the so-called Sprachenkampf was much stronger in the Untersteiermark, southern Styria, but this was part of the SIS state after 1918. So where they were fighting again, for years and decades, house by house, school child by school child, to bring it to the German or to the Slovenian side of that. What you call nationalism from below is much more a German nationalism than a Slovenian nationalism.
Yeah.
The reason is that there is not such a strong Slovenian nationalism is that there is no Slovenian intelligentsia around in the monarchy. There is no university. The largest Slovenian city in the monarchy is Trieste, with the complicated history in 1918, and we will come to Trieste, I think tomorrow, yeah, or this afternoon, and the University of Ljubljana was created in 1920, so after World War I, and the German nationalism was much stronger, because there was some kind of intelligentsia behind. These were the doctors and the notaries who studied in Graz, mm-hmm. and so on. And this German nationalism there was not an intellectual, it was not an urban project, but it was it gave the feeling to the villages there that German culture is superior. If you need a doctor, you have to go to a German-speaking doctor. If you need a notary, you have to go to a German-speaking notary. If you need then you end up with a German-speaking counterpart on the other side of the table. So the superiority of the German culture made it so easy for the Slovenian population to switch or to change their own identity to a half German or fully German identity, because there was no Slovenian counterpart on the other side that could say join us. Yeah. So when the so-called Volksabstimmung, yeah, in Carinthia took place on the 10th of October in 1920, would you like to be a part of Austria or Slovenia? The Slovenians said, Slovenia, we don't matter. We have no Slovenian identity. We want to sell our potatoes in the nearest market, and this is Klagenfurt. We don't want that our sons have to go to the military. And there was an army behind the mountains in the SIS state. So for very practical reasons, there was no serious reason for the Slovenian population that this country was divided along the River Drau. Because they were not in this sense nationalized. So more than half of the Slovenian population voted to stay within Austria. But this was not Austria, because the slogan said, we are not allowed to say to call it Germany. We didn't want to call it Austria. Therefore, we call it Carinthia. So this is the United Carinthia. Bleib Kärntentoy, not Austria, not Germany. Bleib Kärntentoy, Carinthia. So this is a Carinthian identity that jumps over the national identity of Austria to a German identity, as you mentioned, and this was so easy for the Nazis to jump in. This is for this nationalism from below. The other thing is the crypto-Protestantism. This is absolutely a topic. Gerhard Butz tried it 20 years ago, and we had a lot of fun. We shared a room in that time to discuss this. And he said, if you draw a map of all the Austrian locations where in July 1934 the Nazis were relatively successful in doing their putsch against the Ständestaat, and you draw a map of Protestantism and crypto-Protestantism, you see a highly identical map. So you can say that crypto-Protestantism and anti-Viennese and anti-Austrian behavior, because Austria was a Catholic Austria in the Ständestaat, and the crypto-Protestants were, of course, the first that opened the entrance door for Nazi ideology. But it's older. It's not 1934. It's not only the Catholic Ständestaat. It comes from the roots mentioned in there, so that a close view on religious history within Christianity in these regions is absolutely a wonderful topic. I have met farmers who said, oh, since the counter-revolution, we have a Luther people somewhere in our walls hidden, and we still don't believe that the Catholic Church is doing the right thing. And this is of course the entrance door to a specific form of nationalism. Third point, I don't think that the Austro-Marxist stopped writing on the national question because there was no longer an empire to maintain. I have the feeling that they had that even when they had in mind that there is an empire to maintain when they wrote their books on national question, they still did it from a German national perspective. Otto Bauer, Victor Adler, the whole Adler family. I couldn't see too much internationalism in their books, and I have written a lot of things on articles and on that text. Bauer special. He was so. Let me say, he said the loss of South Tyrol is a shock because this is the only place in the world where the South is German. He didn't say, this is a pity, we need a unified Tyrol or whatever. He said, this is a loss because there, this is this old Goethe idea of das Land, wo die Zitronen blühen. Yeah, this is this old view. And he stepped back as foreign minister when the Anschluss was dead. So this is a German national thinking, and if you read his text carefully, you could see that even in his wonderful text on the national question, there's a lot of German national elements in there, and this is true for more than the Otto Bauer people. That I left out the story of the Jews means that the Jews in Carinthia didn't really play a role. There was those anti-Semitism without Jews that we can find everywhere. But it would also be mentioned it yesterday. If you look carefully to the different Jewish communities over the place, they are weak. We had a Kultusgemeinde in Graz. Conservative leading group there, and we have the Jews in southern Burgenland. Their language was Hungarian, and their loyalty goes to Horthy and not to Belakun, of course. So if you look to the different Jewish communities around the place, you will get also very, very different stories. we just have, I could say that there's a huge, there's a lot of work done on David Herzog, the rabbi of Graz, because he has a central role in the university. He was a professor for Semitic languages, and his story, we have a fund named after him, and I'm head of this fund, and so on. But if you look carefully in his political position in the of the Kultusgemeinde in Graz, you could see this is strictly conservative, and also a little bit, let me say, German nationalism looking over the shoulder. This is not a left wing community. So what I'd like to mention is that the Social Democrats, also the leading Social Democrats in Vienna, were not pushed to the German option. They were the pushers. They were the one who pushed others in this direction. But I agree. It was not intended when I wrote this text. I agree that I end up with a religious explanation of the Crimson Sonderweg. Yeah, and this makes me unsafe, yeah, in the moment, and I will think it carefully over if this crypto-Protestantism is really the key to that. We were just kidding Gerhard Butzendorf 20 years ago that this is could be an explanation, but on the other hand, I think if we take it serious, could be that there is really a sense of explanation for a Carinthian Sonderweg in there. Thank you so much for your comments. It opened up my view. Yeah, it opened my eyes. And I will continue in doing this eight different projects under this new with your arguments in there, and it's absolutely helpful. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah. Only a short comment. I'm not so sure that the 58% of the Slovenian vote
for Austria.
Mm-hmm. A lot about the positions of elites, mm-hmm. of the Bauer and others. Also, one can argue that, for instance, Vienna is a little bit more complex in this issue, national question. But if you look at, let's say, if you go to a football stadium in the late 1920s in Vienna, and the game is Austria versus Germany, maybe the impression is a little bit different. Because there's a strong anti-German rivalry, or how to call it exactly. So I come from a completely different religion like you, because I have from a social democrat family without any Nazis in my family, and any Jews, and any Austro-fascists. And I asked once my grandpa his father ever thought that he's a German. My great-grandpa was a big monarchist, and he said never. So this is a completely
different story.
Mm-hmm. I think it's complicated. I'm not so convinced, even if you look at the period after 1945, that it's possible to create a national identity within a few years just by construction. There is something hidden from the monarchy, maybe from the post-nationalist period, let's say before 1880 or the earlier time, which comes on the surface in 45 and later on. This is my impression. I'm not sure if it's right, but and I think we should have something in addition. We should keep in mind that extreme situation in Carinthia in 1920 or 1980. Let's about the situation if now Mexico is claiming that Southern California will be a part of Mexico? How would be the situation for Hispanics in Southern California if Americans ask them, are you really American or do you want to be a Mexican citizen? So even now, in our days, I'm not sure if there will not be some pressure on the Hispanics in Southern California to vote for the US and not for, for Mexico.
Yes, there's a big but.
Yeah.
Austria was the loser in World War One, and the SIS state was the winner. So the rich country was the southern, what the solution to go to the SIS state. So you couldn't compare this fairly. I'm with you that there is a rival situation between Austria and Germany, especially in sports. You can see it till to the Anschluss game. So this is a complex story of a friendly, let me say, situation of contrahents. But I think, of course, your family story and my family story are completely different. I had to read Schiller. My first lines were Schiller and Goethe because my father was a teacher then, and he said, this German classic literature is the literature that you have to be raised in. So I know Goethe's Faust from the first line till the last. You can ask me. Yeah? I can speak any line of this, and this is my father's influence. Yeah, the German culture is the culture where we have to be proud of. It's the leading culture in the world. And if you know Goethe, yeah, you are a person. Yeah, and not those or these others around. So this is very, very different. So I was raised to be a left-wing social democrat, but with a German cultural perspective. And this is different regions in Austria, different stories, as I told you. Of course, the situation in southern Carinthia at the end of World War I was under enormous pressure. But if you think that you can vote for Slovenia or for the SIS state and you are on the winning side, yeah. Think of the situation in Saint-Germain. So sitting on the right side of the table, that's something, yeah. And then to vote for the loser, yeah, that meant that there are economic interests, that there are simply geographical ways. There is the border; you couldn't cross the mountains in winter, yeah, to go for the market and things like that. And the military question, of course.
Since we're almost out of time,
let's take it.
I'd like to collect the questions so that it's on, ping pong, and then we can maybe open up the discussion. But I think there's one, two, at least. And then are there other people who would like to ask a question?
Bila?
Yeah, I just get your dispute. I'm not sure whether it was a dispute or a question of a nationalization from below. There was a kind of a contradiction then when you say there was a nationalization vote, and you say the Slovenes voted for, and then it's a question of loyalty or identity, kind of different, it contradicts the concept because they were not nationalizing, they had simply practical interests. That's all, and it kind of contradicts. And on the German side, I would think it's a question of modernization, but not exactly nationalization. I mean, that's what you argue is that the German part was the most modernizing part, and that's the reason talk for that, and not any ethnic or language reason. That would be my argument. That was not the case. And I would kind of just over
I'm fully with you. This is just the way up. The original elites, and they opened the door to you and give you a special education and special political directions. You end up in the Turnerbund.
You can have it. What you are hearing out here, I mean, is again an attempt to get back the national question to the social question,
yeah.
i.e. to get back to the social and economic explanation. So you have to decide, Helmut. I mean, is it religion and culture that are bad, or is it social and economy and so on? They are trying to detract you from your revisionism.
Why have you to decide? I think there is an element of a social explanation in there, even in my family story. You couldn't say no to that. If the priest would have opened the door to my father, come to the priest seminar and be a Catholic priest, I wouldn't be here, possibly. But this would be the other way of the career. So it ends up to some extent on the social level. But nationalism from below, I think, is the central question. The German nationalism is not just from below; it's coming from a local elite educated in universities and in the German national surroundings, and they made pressure. And there is no Slovenian answer. So the Slovenian nationalism is a real nationalism from below, but just let me say. There's just a grain in the ground. You couldn't see this. So the decision to say yes to Carinthia, I had still the feeling that Carinthia was also not a very successful, but it was an entity that worked, that gave the chances to different markets and there was the railroad, there was the streets leading to Klagenfurt, to Villach, and there were no crossing mountains possibilities. So I think that this 58% of Slovenes, yeah, I don't know what the Slovene is, but those who said we use Slovenian language at all, that vote to stay within Carinthia, they did for, let me say, practical reasons mostly, and not for ideological reasons. They don't want to be part of a German culture, but they said, I want to sell my potatoes, yeah? And they want to keep my son at home and not in the army. Things like that. So it's complicated. You see, there's a time difference in building up national stories and identities, and the Germans were at least two decades in front of the Slovenians there. So it was easy to dominate in this national question and to give the feeling that German nationalism or German culture, whatever, is superior to the Slovenian culture. It still happens there. So if I could make an excursion with you to the villages and to see what it really means to say I'm Slovenian. This is inferior there to some parts up till now, and there are wonderful literary texts on that. Peter Handke wrote "Immer noch Sturm" to show that there is still storm there. Maya Hadalab, Engel des Vergessens, with the Paul Klee angel of history in mind, and Walter Benjamin. So this is all. Even up till now, a very complicated story. And that they threw me out from the Social Democratic Party, and the whole group of young socialist students is just a clear reaction. If you touch this in a way to make fun out of our German national identity within the social democracy, you are no longer part of our group.
Thank you.